Good morning, all. Why today's strength is very less? In yesterday's class, 46, 47 students were there. Why today only 37 students? Put one message in the group now. Tell them to join immediately. Yes, student, let them join. I'll start with my class. In last class, we have seen the .NET framework architecture. In last class I explained two architectures. Is my screen is visible?
Yes.
Students, I'll begin with my class. In last class, we have seen the architecture of .NET framework. I had explained you the architecture of .NET framework. Can you see the PPT, students, all of you? Is my PPT is visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. So before the architecture of framework, we have seen in last class, we have seen some of the benefits. Students, in last class, this is ease of deployment, not development, ease of deployment. So in last class, we have seen consistent programming model, cross-platform, language interpretability, automatic memory management of resources. You can say automatic memory management, or you can also say automatic management of resources. See, resources is nothing but memory only. We are talking about memory only. In C#, it allows automatic memory management. Once that file or the resource or the memory is no longer in use, then it will be deallocated automatically. No need, it will not wait for the destructor to deallocate. Why we use constructor to initialize, to allocate the memory? We use constructor to deallocate the memory. We use destructor in Java programming language. But in C#.NET, in .NET framework, we don't, no need to use of any destructor explicitly. Using the most important benefit or feature of this .NET framework is it manages the memory automatically, or you can say automatic management of resources, or you can say automatic memory management and ease of deployment. Ease of deployment is means when you deploy your .NET project, then it will not affect to your system. Some projects or some application or some software, if you install that particular software, it will not allow other software to work. But in the case of .NET framework, it will not create any problem for other programming languages or other softwares. So this we have seen in the last class, and we have also seen the architecture of .NET framework yesterday. Was the diagram was clear? See, please student respond, because this video will be uploaded in the YouTube channel, our department YouTube channel. If this diagram is not clear, you please tell me. See students, once again I'll repeat this. See here, I'm using a highlighter. See, this is a .NET framework architecture, and in this here we are going to learn using this .NET framework what feature we are going to utilize, or what are the features this .NET framework has. Using this .NET framework, we can create a user interface. User interface is nothing but a GUIs. You can create a GUIs, and here it has the services. What type of services? Is my pointer is visible to all of you? Okay. Then data access. Data, this is the data. If I highlight, I think now you can see it clearly. It is a data access. This in last class we have seen already, but the image was not clear, so that's why I'm repeating again. And the core part of this framework, the it contains the parallel extension, managed extensibility framework, LINQ. See what is LINQ, what is managed extensibility. We'll see when we see the components in detail. We'll see in detail all those. So languages. What are the languages .NET framework supports? What are the languages .NET framework supports? .NET framework supports many programming languages, for example, such as J#, C#, VB.NET, ASP.NET, and so on. And it allows for the dynamic language runtime. It allows for dynamic language runtime, and it has a base class library. What is base class library? Also, we'll see in the components. This is all about the .NET framework architecture. Is this diagram is clear to everybody? Using this .NET framework, you can create user interface. It provides services such as a fast service, that is velocity. Velocity is nothing but a speed, and it also provides a data services, and it allows the Windows present communication foundation and Windows workflow foundation, and it also shows it also helps us to access the data from the database. Yes, students, in last class also I told you .NET framework has built-in server, that is IIS server. This built-in server, that is IIS server, we have. And before going to the components, in last class I told you, in next class we will see the components of .NET framework. So before going to my components topic, first we'll have some exercise. That is, in last class what we have learned. I'll ask questions. You can answer in the chat box, and randomly to one or two students I'll tell them to answer. So in the year .NET framework 3.0, in which year they have invented? Ashwini, .NET framework. Ashwini, yes, very good, very good. I am getting the responses in the message box. Good. Yes, in the year 2006, .NET 3.0 has invented. Ashwini, you are listening to me? Ashwini?
Yes, ma'am.
You got the answer, Ashwini?
Yes, ma'am, I got.
Okay, good. Okay, next, .NET. When Java has introduced? It's 1995, and you can also say mid-90s. Mid-90s or 1995. When J2EE has introduced J2EE? Java Enterprise Edition, J2EE, yes, good. In the year 2002, J2EE has introduced. And for your syllabus, which framework, which version of .NET framework you are learning for your syllabus? For your syllabus, yes, .NET 4.0. .NET framework 4.0 you are learning for in your syllabus. Yes, my students are attentive in the class. I'm happy. Okay, coming back, and what are the benefits of .NET framework? Chetana, K Chetana, what are the benefits of .NET framework? Just now, Apurva.
SVAM consistent programming model, cross platform support, automatic management of resources, ease of deployment,
good,
security. Oh no, I'm sorry.
Okay, Nazma. Nazma.
Yes, ma'am.
Components of .NET framework. Benefits of .NET framework.
Consistent programming model, cross-platform support, language interpretability, automatic management of resource, and ease of development.
Deployment. Ease of deployment. Good. And Gunashekar, the most important components of .NET framework. Gunashekar. Gunashekar, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
There are many components of .NET framework, but in last class I told the most three important components of .NET framework. CLR, CLS, and CTS. CLR, CLS, and CTS are the three most important components of .NET framework. CLR is Common Language Runtime, CLS is Common Language Specification, CTS is Common Specification. These three are the main three components of .NET framework. In which year .NET framework has evolved or introduced or developed? In which year .NET framework has developed? February 10, 2002. Microsoft people, they have introduced .NET framework 1.0. 1.0 is the first version of .NET framework. Yes. Okay. Now we'll begin with, we'll come back to our class. Yes, students, in last class, I shown you this .NET framework diagram also, and I have shown you this diagram also. See, this .NET framework, I'm not saying it is wrong. This also has us all the components the .NET framework should have, but in exam or for your internals, you need to write this diagram. And today I'll show you one more .NET framework. See, don't get confused. All the framework diagrams are same. Here, this is also a framework of, this is also a .NET framework diagram. Yes, students, if you remember the scanned diagram which I shown you, the scanned diagram, there also you can, there we have the, there what we have, the interfaces, libraries, interface services, and data access. And here also we have everything, the library. The base class library, the forms using a ASP.NET, and using a WinForm also, you can create forms, a desktop form, that is window forms, and ADO.NET, data.net entity framework, LINQ for database, and parallel extension also it was there, and using ASP.NET, a web API also you can develop. Yes, it's all this whatever we have seen in .NET framework 4.0 all are available here. This is .NET framework 4.5 architecture. Yes, students, don't get confused. If you Google for .NET framework diagram, you will get n number of diagrams. But for your test, you need to write this. You should not do mistake in your test or in your external exam. That's why I am showing the all the .NET framework which are available. .NET framework diagrams. Yes, students, understood. So next we'll come to the components. This is the most important topic in. This is the most important topic in this .NET framework, that is the components of .NET framework. We have many components of .NET framework, but three important components of .NET framework is common language runtime, common type specification, and common language specification. First, we'll see common language runtime. It is a most important component of .NET framework. It allows for memory management. It allows for memory management, exception handling, debugging, security, and thread execution. So this common language runtime, this is a base for this .NET framework. Based on this only, the .NET framework works. The .NET, the CLR allows for the memory management or the management of resources. You can also say management of resources, or you can management exception handling if any error occurs, then it throws an exception. In your other programming languages also you have learned, you have executed this exception handling programs. So it helps in exception handling, it helps in the debugging of the program, and it also provides a security to your code. It also provides a security to your code, and it helps you to execute the threads. And this, I'll come to this point. This CLR, the CLR also supports for various resources such as collection, arrays, operating system, folders. So the CLR also helps to support for various resources such as collection, arrays, and handling the operating system. And this CLR, automatically runs automatically release of the object when there is no longer in use. This is nothing but a memory management. If any object is not in use, if the particular object is no longer in use, if a particular project object is not used in future, then the memory management will be done, means the memory will be deallocated automatically. And coming to this managed code, so in .NET framework we have two types of code. One is managed code and the other one is unmanaged code. This also I have told here. So the first one is managed code, and we have a unmanaged code also. This managed code executes directly by the CLR. When we say it executes with the help of CLR, then it also gets a facility or the features whatever we have for CLR, that is management, exception handling, debugging, security, and thread execution. So in managed code, when we say it is a managed code, it has some procedure or it has some step to execute a program. That is, first it selects the compiler, next it compiles the code to a IL, is intermediate language. See, students, as I told in previous classes. Using this .NET framework, you can execute JHash program, you can execute CHash program, you can execute VB.NET, you can execute CHash.NET. So first, when you execute your code using this managed code, first it will select for the language compiler, and then it will transfer the code into the intermediate language. It will transfer the code into the intermediate language. Then the compiler will the compiling intermediate language to the native code. Native code means whichever the code the compiler will understand, and then it will execute the code. So this is a process of this managed code. This is a process of this managed code, or this is a procedure this managed code will follow. And we have also have a unmanaged code. Unmanaged code means, when you say unmanaged code means, then that will not execute direct, that will not execute with the help of a CLR. That will not execute with the help of a CLR directly. That code will be deployed to the compiler, and it will execute and it will show the output. That unmanaged code will not go through this process. That unmanaged code will not go through this process. Directly the code will be executed in the compiler, and it will show the output. So this is about CLR. The students understood what a CLR is. A CLR is a very important component of .NET framework. The CLR allows for the memory management, exception handling, debugging, and it also provides a security to your code. And in CLR, we have a managed code. When you say a managed code, it executes the program directly by the compiler. When it is executing the code by the compiler, then it will follow this procedure. What is the procedure? First, it will select the language compiler, then the compiling the code to the intermediate language, then intermediate language to the native mode, then the code will be executed. And in CLR, we have one more very important feature, that is runtime automatically release the object when they are no longer in use. If any particular object is not used, if any particular object is no longer in use or not used in future, then that memory space will be deallocated automatically. So this is all about CLR. Yes, students understood? And next we have common type specification. See, when we say type specification means it is mainly related with the data types. It is mainly related with the data types which we are going to use in the .NET framework. See, in short, this common type specification we call as a CTS. This CTS specifies certain guidelines for declaring. It specifies certain guidelines for declaring, using, and managing the type at the runtime. And this CTS also helps in cross-language specification. As we all know, it provides a facility to execute different types of programming language. That's why it helps us in cross-language specification. And this CTS supports object-oriented model to implement different programming languages, and it supports primitive data type. Students, is this can you see the diagram? Please tell me, is it clear? Can you see the
Not clear, ma'am.
Shall I read out the fields?
Yes, ma'am.
Because in my PPT it is clear, so that's why I want to know whether whether it is clear or not. See here, see students, with the highlighter I'm showing. This is type is nothing but a data type, and the data type is divided into two categories: value type and reference type. value type and reference type. What is the difference between value type and reference type? In pointers we have studied in C program. What is value type and reference type? Value type means the actual value. Reference type means the address of the value. Yes, students, you know this.
Value type allocated on stack and allocated on heap reference type.
Huh? Amit?
Allocated on stack, value type man.
Okay.
And reference type allocated on heap.
On heap, yes, correct. The value is that is also a right answer. Value type is stored on a stack and the reference type is stored on a heap. Reference type is stored on a heap. In addition to that, a value type means a actual value and the reference type means a reference type is a address of the value. Address of the value. And then this static and heap will come. That static value will be stored, the value type will be stored in static memory and the reference type will be stored in the heap memory. So now in value type, again it is categorized, that is built-in value types and the user-defined value types. What are the built-in value types? What are the built-in data types? Int, float. Yes, students, you remember?
Yes, ma'am.
Int, float, char, double, these are all the value type. And in .NET framework, you can also define a user-defined data type. User-defined data type, such as user-defined data type, and that is enumeration data type. That is, in short, you call as a enum. So these three is categorized under value type data type. And we have a reference type data type. It's now when I highlight whether you are able to see the what text has written there. Hey, students?
No.
Okay. Now I'll explain in tomorrow's class once again. In next class also once again I'll try to find some other diagram and I'll try to show. But okay, students, in my PPT it is clear. Okay. So reference.
And zoom madboda nodi.
Yes.
Zoom madboda nodi, ma'am.
Zoom, ma'am. Correct. No.
Pretty hard.
Zoom alo barta illa. Ah, yes. So now can you see, students?
Yes, ma'am.
Type. See, under this type is a. This type is divided into two categories: value type and reference type. Can you see the hand pointer? Value type and reference type. And this value type is, this is divided into built-in value types, user-defined value types, and enumeration data type. Enumeration data type is a user-defined data type. This is defined by the user. For example, group of colors, group of fruits, group of vegetables. So here the reference type. Can you see now, students?
Yes, ma'am.
Reference type. Under reference type, we have pointer type. Pointer type is nothing but a address of a variable. Address of a variable. Interface type. What is interface type? What is interface type? Any answer?
Copy, ma'am. Copy constructor.
Correct. And next, the self-describing data type, that is arrays. Yes, arrays are self-describing data type. Under that, we have one more data type, that is class. Class type. Class type is divided into user-defined class, boxed value types, and delegates. User-defined data types, that is defined by the user, boxed value type. Boxed value type is the value. This is also similar to the user-defined data type. This is also similar to user-defined data type. Here we declare integer, float, double, value. And here, the very important thing, we have delegate. See, this delegate has a reference of the function, or this delegate have reference of method. For example, if you are executing a program to add two numbers using function, if you are executing a program to add two numbers using function, so see, to add two number, you can write a simple program also, and you can also run write a program using function also. Yes, students, you can write now, in both the ways you can write. This del is of yes, please respond. You're listening. Okay, to add two numbers, you can write a program using three variables. Take three variables A, B, C, and take two inputs in the variable A and B, and add those two numbers and store in the variable C, and you can display the output. That is one way of displaying the sum of two numbers. You can also execute the same program using function. And for that code, that to add two numbers, that code you can write in the function, and you can call that function to your main program. That is also one method to demonstrate function in any programming languages. So this delegate holds the address of the method. What the pointer hold? Pointer holds the address of the variable. Correct, no? Pointer holds the address of variable. Similarly, this delegate holds the address of a function or address of a method. Understood? Yes, students, understood?
Yes, ma'am.
And student, this in the user defined value, you can declare any variable. So this boxed value type is using this user defined data type. Whatever the you declare, this boxed value type, it holds the address of those variables. Say for example, integer.
Ma'am, that's not a user defined variable. It's classes, ma'am.
User defined classes. So user defined classes means program class, a student class. Student class may be having a different objects, a class with a name teacher, a class name with the students. So you can also have an abstract class. What is the difference between abstract class and a normal class? Yes, what is the difference between abstract class and a normal class? For abstract class, there is no need to create a instance. Okay, so that we'll see in detail in the future classes, but here we are, I am explaining only the types or the data types which we are going to use in the .NET framework. So here we have user defined classes, boxed value types, and delegates. The students understood? Boxed value type means it holds the address, and delegates holds the address of a method. Understood? Yes, students understood?
Ma'am, what is boxed value type? Can you explain one more time?
See, boxed value type means it is a address of a variable. You have, for your lab-less program, you have a boxed and unboxed program. Boxed and unboxed program. Box means the actual value. sorry, box means the address of the variable.
Okay, ma'am.
So next we have a common language specification. This is also a one of the important component of .NET framework. In short, we call as a CLS. CLS the following actions, that is, it establish a framework that helps enable cross language integration and type safety and high performance code execution. So these are all the functions of CLS. It establish a framework that helps to enable the cross language specification, because in .NET framework allows us to execute different types of programming languages. So that's the reason why here we are telling it as a, it enables cross language integration and type safety. Type safety means whichever the types of data type you declare, it allows you to execute those programs, and it is a high performance code execution platform. This .NET framework is a high performance code execution platform, and it provides object oriented model that supports the complete implementation of many programming language. It provides a object oriented model. It supports the complete implementation of many programming language. Which are the programming languages we are executing here in .NET framework? C hash, J hash, VB, and so on. And it defines the rules. It defines the rules that languages must follow. The language, which are the languages using this .NET framework, which are the languages we are executing, those languages should follow whatever the instructions given by the common language specification. So it defines some of the rules. It defines some of the rules that must be followed, which helps us to ensure that the object written in different languages can interact with each other. So some set of predefined rules will be there. So using those rules, we have to declare the variables. So next we have other components of .NET framework. Other components of .NET framework. In that, the first one is metadata and assemblies. See, metadata is nothing but a metadata is binary information that describes your program. That metadata is a binary information that describes your program and stored in CLR portable extension. The portable extension PE file in the memory. Understood? This metadata is a, it contains the binary information of your program. It is stored in the CLR with a .PE extension. And next we have assemblies. What is assembly? Assembly is a logical unit that consists of four elements. That is manifest, type metadata, intermediate language, and set of resources. The assembly contains four logical units. Those are manifest, type data, intermediate language, and the set of resources. These four components consist in this assemblies. And we have framework class library. The .NET framework class library has the .NET framework class library consists of classes, objects, interfaces, value types, value types, encapsulating the data type, accessing the information about the loaded type, and calling the .NET framework security check, and it also facilitates the data access. Hey, students, this .NET framework, this .NET library, it has some of the functions. This .NET framework library consists of classes, objects, interfaces, and it has some of the functions. Some of the functions, that is data type execution, encapsulating the data structure, performing the input-output operation, information from the database, and checking for the security, and it also helps us to facilitate the data access from client side, and it also helps us to create a GUI. Understood? The .NET framework contains the .NET framework class library consists of classes, objects, interfaces, and it has some of the functions: the function handling, data access, encapsulating the data structures, execution of input-output statement, checking for the security, and creation of a interface. These are all the functions of .NET framework class library. Understood? And next we have Windows form. As I told in the first class, using this .NET framework, you can develop two types of applications. You can develop two types of application, that is Windows application and web application. Using this window application, you can develop a standalone application, means that application is used in only that particular system only. So to design this window form, with the help of this window form, you can create a attractive GUI, graphical user interface. You can create a attractive GUI. We have here in .NET framework, we have a toolbox. Using toolbox, the toolbox will help us to, the toolbox contains label, text box, grid view, all chat box, radio button, so many options are available in the toolbox. Using those options, you can create a form. And you also have ASP.NET. With the help of ASP.NET, you can create a web application. You can create a web application. To develop a web application, again, we have a toolbox in .NET framework. Using that toolbox, you can develop a different forms. The students, in the first class, I shown you now. Once again, I'll show you. Yes, you understood the components, metadata, assembly, .NET framework, class library, WinForm. Students, any doubt? Any doubt, students?
No, ma'am.
See, one second, I'll show you, students. Students, here the screen is visible. Visual Studio is visible.
Yes, ma'am.
See students, if you see, is the screen is clear now? See here, here Windows form application. Window form application is there. To this window form application, see, can you see the symbol here? C hash. Can you see the symbol?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. When I click on this, when I click, see. For this window form application, the file name is Windows Form Application 3. Yes, the file name is Window Form Application 3. If I click on ASP web application, and here the file name change. Here, why the file name change? Using this ASP.NET, we are able to execute or we are able to develop a web applications. So that's why by default it will take a file name as web only. So web application one. And if you observe, you can see here the globe backside. Yes, you can see the globe. The meaning is you can create a web page. But for this standalone, for this web Windows form application, we don't have that. Only a simple projects. A standalone Windows-based project you can develop, but using this ASP.NET you can develop a web projects. Understood, students? Using .NET framework you can execute two types of applications or two types of projects. So we have seen the metadata, assembly, .NET framework, class library, WinForm, ASP.NET also we have seen. ASP.NET, Ajax, Edio.NET, Window, Workflow Foundation, Presentation Foundation, Communication Foundation. These we'll see in the next class. Okay, students? Understood today's topic?
Yes, ma'am.
You see, even the diagram also. See, even the diagram also clear now, no? Even the diagram is
not yes, ma'am.
Clear. Okay, students, I'll stop here. We'll see in the next class.